So tonight's talk is called Love Without Limits. And we've started a new theme. Last week, Bodhinaga started a new theme called Gateways to Enlightenment. Gateways to Enlightenment. And the theme is based around something that's difficult to describe. It's called the Mandala of the Five Buddhas, or the Five Conquerors. And Bodhinaga did a very good job last week of explaining what this is. It's not quite a symbol, that wouldn't be doing it justice. It's a bit like a map to enlightenment, or, you know, kind of, Bodhinaga talked about how you get car manuals and you zoom in on parts of a car and it kind of expands, and the diagram just zooms out in different directions, and you can zoom in on a part of it. So the mandala of the five Buddhas does that with enlightenment, with the qualities of enlightenment. You can either look at enlightenment as a whole, or you can kind of expand and zoom into particular aspects of enlightenment, the kind of the heart, the feeling aspects, or the wisdom aspects, or the energy aspects. And there's an analogy that's used, which sometimes is though like the enlightened mind is if it's like a shaft of white light, and if it hits a prism, the prism would break it into coloured light of different wavelengths, different colours. So you'd get the red light, you get the green light, the blue light. But it's all, you know, when it's put back together, it's all come from that same source, that same white light. So you could say it's the same, these five different Buddhas. They're each a different colour, and they've each got different qualities. They emphasise different aspects of enlightenment. But they all come from the same source of enlightenment, the enlightened mind. So maybe if I show some diagrams, some pictures, it might be more helpful to get a sense of it. But so it's called a mandala of five Buddhas, and mandala, sometimes translated as something like sacred circle, sacred spaces. Mandalas used in different types of Buddhism. We don't use them so often, but this is a particular mandala that we do emphasize, the mandala of the five Buddhas. So you've got five different coloured Buddhas in different directions, the different directions of space. The red Buddha is in the west. For some reason, on this diagram, is up at the top. So you have to imagine that west is up at the top in this diagram. But you've got red Buddha Amitabha in the west. In the east, you've got a blue Buddha Akshobhya. In the south, you've got a golden Buddha Ratnasambhava. In the north, you've got a dark green Buddha Amoghasiddhi. And in the centre, you've got, illuminating the whole mandala, a brilliant white Buddha called Virochana. And there's a diagram of them all kind of side by side. It's going to be easier to see them a bit larger there. So you've got these five Buddhas. So, yeah, they've each got distinct qualities. They emphasise distinct qualities of enlightenment. There's a lot of very rich symbolism surrounding them, which we're going to explore over the next few weeks, the next 12 weeks or so. Bodhinaga described it last week, and the title or the theme of our series is Gateways to Enlightenment. So maybe a really helpful way of engaging with these Buddhas is that they are a gateway into enlightenment. So last week, Bodhinaga said, I think it might be a story or kind of a folk tale, a kind of joke almost. Like, somebody's going, wants to know, they're starting off in a rural countryside, they want to know how to get to London. And they ask a farmer, and the farmer says, oh, I wouldn't start from here. I definitely wouldn't start from here. And there's a sense in which it's like that with enlightenment. You know, we're trying to get, you know, we've got this analogy of trying to reach a destination, a goal. And we probably wouldn't start from here if we wanted to get enlightened. We wouldn't start from where we are. But unfortunately, we have to. We have to start from where we are. We have to get real about who we are and where we are and start from where we are. And we're all very, very different. We're all very, very different people. If I look around this room and look around our Sangha, the people that I'm friends with in our Sangha, some amazing people, but really, really different types of people, very varied personalities and types of people. So there's no kind of one-size-fits-all path to enlightenment. It's more like you need to find the kind of path that fits you, the gateway to enlightenment that fits you. So these different coloured Buddhas, and you'll see as we explore them, they represent different paths, different gateways that might suit different people. And it's not that, you know, there's kind of, when people are enlightened, they're kind of, they've got different types of wisdom and they're all different from each other. There's only one enlightenment experience, but this, you might say, this is from the lens of an unenlightened, the viewpoint of an unenlightened person. It looks as though there's like different, well, there are different paths, different ways, And they look like distinct Buddhas, different Buddhas. But in a way, they all represent the same enlightenment, experience ultimately. Yeah. So each of these Buddhas has a particular poison that they transform. So we heard about Akshobhya last week. He transforms a poison of hatred. And they each transform it into a particular wisdom, a particular enlightened wisdom. So Akshobhya transforms hatred into a clear mirror-like wisdom that can really see things very, very clearly. And it's said that Akshobhya might be attractive to a particular type of person who might be a kind of a grumpy person, somebody who likes to get to the truth, likes to see the truth, get straight to the truth, and isn't really concerned about who gets upset along the way. A real Akshobhya type is somebody who's really, truth is important to them and not really people's feelings. But that, that strength can be transformed into an enlightened quality that which sees things, really sees the qualities. It can see things very, very clearly, wisdom. And we heard that Ratnasambhava transforms a poison of pride into a wisdom that sees the sameness in all living beings. We heard that Amoghasiddhi in the north, he, mysterious figure, dark green figure, that he transforms the poison of envy, of jealousy, into the all-accomplishing wisdom, the wisdom that accomplishes unstoppable success. This evening I'm going to focus on a Buddha, the Red Buddha in the West called Amitabha, and I'm going to explore and focus in particular detail on the Red Buddha Amitabha. Vidanya's talk is well worth listening to last week if you didn't hear it, because there was a sense in which you can look at your almost at your personality type and think, well, am I somebody who is a bit proud, suffers with pride or jealousy or hatred? You can get a flavour of these different types of Buddhas and these different types of almost personality types. You can see it in quite a psychological way, a way of approaching these. And you need to have a sense of your strengths and weaknesses. And we need to balance our weaknesses out. We need to work on our weaknesses and become more rounded. But actually, the route to the path to enlightenment for us are going to come through our particular strengths. What are our particular strengths? So this evening I'm going to be looking at Amitabha, the figure of Amitabha, which you could say is the path of the heart, the path of love, of compassion, of emotion. If that's a particular strength for you, that this could be a path, this could be an attractive path for some people. And this is the Buddha that I undertook to visualize. This is the Buddha that I connect with, it's my sadhana practice, my yidam practice. So each day I connect with Amitabha, the figure of Amitabha, and it's my path to enlightenment, my gateway to enlightenment. So Amitabha is my man, red is my color, even though I'm not wearing red this evening, and Amitabha is my man. So, there's a picture of Akshobhya I forgot to show you, and there's a picture of Akshobhya I forgot to show you, and there's a picture of Amoghasiddhi. So over the coming weeks, you'll get to see, we're going to focus in more detail on these different figures, so you'll get to hear more about their qualities, more about the path that they represent. But this evening, it's going to be the Red Buddha Amitabha, the path of the heart, of compassion, of love. So, for me, that's very, very attractive, that the path of love and compassion, of altruism, can be a way to become enlightened. It can be a way to wisdom. So let's explore this figure of Amitabha. So Amitabha is a deep red, a ruby red colour. He's associated with the West. So each of these Buddhas has a direction. So Amitabha is said to be based in the West of the Mandala. And each of the Buddhas has a particular time of day that they're associated with. And Amitabha is sunset. It's associated with the red sky and the setting sun. He's associated with transforming, transmuting the poison of greed and craving. So if you're a particular kind of person who, emotion is strong for you, friendliness comes naturally to you, warmth comes naturally to you, but maybe less so kind of wisdom, clear thinking, but maybe might be kind of heart person. But you might also find that you might be a bit greedy. You might have a kind of sweet tooth or a soft spot for attractive people, or you might have addictive tendencies. Then Amitabha could be your man. He's my man. So it gives you kind of a window into my personality, my psyche. So maybe people who they're warm, they're friendly, but maybe perhaps their relationships can tend to be a bit kind of sticky, a bit possessive, a bit compulsive, a bit needy. Amitabha could be the man for you. So Amitabha transmutes that craving, that greed, into what's called a discriminating wisdom. I find this a confusing term, because discriminating is usually seen as being a bad thing. We talk about discriminating against people. Actually, Amitabha, you could say, discriminates for people. Amitabha, the wisdom of Amitabha, sees what is unique and positive about people, what are their unique positive qualities, and really, really loves them for those qualities. Amitabha really loves people for what's uniquely positive about them, what's unique about them. So you can see how somebody who is a bit greedy, or got that kind of addictive, greedy kind of craving tendency, might have a tendency, a kind of strength, almost an advantage in this area. You can spot what's attractive about something, what is desirable about something, you really want it, what is attractive about a person, and you really want them. So if your craving is a big poison for you, then actually that can be transformed into spotting what's really, really good about something, really uniquely attractive about something, and not necessarily needing to have it and consume it, but just loving it for what it is, appreciating it and loving it for its own, or their own beauty, their own unique qualities. So devotees of Amitabha, the people who might practice this, the path of Amitabha, the path of the heart, passionate, feeling heart types. But the figure of Amitabha is a very calm, composed figure. If you look at this figure of Amitabha, seated in meditation posture, his mudra is a mudra of meditation with his hands folded. He's deep in concentration, deep in meditation. But his eyes are slightly open. He's looking out on the world with kindness and compassion. Very, very relaxed, very, very approachable Buddha figure. In fact, the most common Buddha figure you'll see is the meditating Buddha, Amitabha. Amitabha is seated there. And instead of passion of somebody who's unenlightened, untrained, their mind, their heart is untrained, the passion is wild, all over the place, undisciplined, Amitabha is contained. He's sitting there composed, contained, but just love pouring out, radiating out in all directions. So it's said that the name Amitabha means infinite light. And for me, this helps me to get a sense of, well, there's this light, red light of Amitabha just radiating out, this metta, loving kindness, just pouring out of this Buddha meditating in the West, Amitabha. Each of the Buddhas is said to be the head of a family of archetypal figures, of Buddhas or Bodhisattvas figures. Amitabha's family, his particular symbol is the lotus. He's the head of the lotus family. So he's seated on a red lotus, and the symbol of the lotus is very significant around Amitabha. And one of the things it symbolises is organic growth, that the path of Buddhism, it can be all about trying, that's really important, making our own effort is really important. But there's also a sense in which you provide the conditions, you put the conditions in place, and plants will grow, lotus will grow. If you provide soil, if you provide light, you can't kind of force a flower to grow. The work you have to do is to put the seed in the right conditions, nurture those conditions in a way, kind of get rid of the weeds, provide fertilizer, soil. But you can't force a plant to happen, it just happens organically. So that kind of gives a flavour of kind of the nature of the Amitabha path in a way. There's a receptivity, there's a kind of an unfolding associated with Amitabha, maybe more so than a kind of a striving. Yeah, so the sense in which you will trust the practices, you'll have real confidence. You could say there's a term, shraddha, that Mokshita will be exploring next week. You'll have a real conviction in the practices, a confidence in the practices. So you can just relax, you can do the practices wholeheartedly, and just relax and let the fruits unfold, let the fruits happen. So there's another side, there's a compassion and love side of Amitabha. Next week, Mokshita is going to explore another set of emotions associated with Amitabha, which is If you really passionately care about something, an ideal, something very valuable, then what, there's a set of emotions which are reverence, devotion, and this term Shraddha. So that's another big part of Amitabha, which Moksha Tara is going to explore next week. And I say, yeah, I've recently had a second child, a daughter, and we called her Grace. And the reason we chose to call her Grace is partly connected to Amitabha. There's a side of Amitabha which, again, I associate with sunlight and growth. For me, there's a kind of poetic symbolism of if you've got a kind of seed or a kind of bulb in the soil, you know, it might be surrounded by worms and kind of dirt and mud. But as long as it feels the sun, it feels the kind of heat and the warmth of the sun, it will kind of grow towards it. It will kind of find its way towards the sun and grow in the right direction. And the sense in which we might have, part of us knows, but you could say there's a kind of higher self, a wise part of us that knows the direction to go to. You could even see it as a kind of a figure like Amitabha, an enlightened mind kind of calling to us, or it could be our higher self calling to us. And we've got an inner faculty which can hear it, but usually our mind is too noisy, our heart is too noisy. So, whenever I feel the sunlight or the warmth on me when I'm out and about, it reminds me of Amitabha, it reminds me, well, that's the ideal, that's the path, that's the kind of the direction my heart wants to go to, my kind of higher self is calling me towards. So, it's said there's sometimes devotees of Amitabha describe themselves as, you know, having the grace of Amitabha helping them, almost assisting them, guiding them in the right direction. So yeah, Amitabha is the figure that I really have got hooked into as the kind of the gateway to enlightenment for me. It's the kind of the symbol of enlightenment that's most vivid, most rich, most alive for me. And then initially my connection with Amitabha started at my Mitra ceremony. I became a Mitra a long time ago now, 2006. And we chanted the mantra of Amitabha in the Mitra ceremony. It just transported me really, really kind of took me to a different place. Wow, what is this mantra? This is amazing, really beautiful, real beauty about this mantra, really attractive mantra. So that was from that point I was hooked really. That was kind of my connection with Amitabha was sealed at that point really. But then there are other associations. Red is the colour of my team, Liverpool, so red is my favourite colour. I don't know if I picked Amitabha picked me or I picked Amitabha because of that, but the red is a very strong, important colour for me. And then the sunlight, the idea of sunlight is really important to me as well. Kind of, I suppose since taking the practice of Amitabha, whenever I see sunlight in water or just sunlight reflected on things, it reminds me of that wisdom of Amitabha to appreciate the beauty. It takes me into a different state of mind that's more appreciative, looking for what's best around me, beauty around me. And when I was just about to be ordained by a Mogavanksa, just for my private ordination ceremony, I suffer with doubt as well as craving. I still undecided what I'm going to choose. What Buddha should I choose to meditate on? I had a kind of two or three I was toying with. And I was meditating in the hut before I was going to go to be ordained, and I just decided to drop this question after a puja. Which Buddha should I take? And then the answer came back. Felt like from the depths of my being, Amitabha. And I decided to ask three times, because that's traditionally what Buddhist questions are asked three times. So I decided to ask it three times, and each time I got this kind of response, Amitabha. And then I opened my eyes at the end of the puja, and the hut was just filled with red light, which took me by surprise. So I closed my eyes again, opened them again, and the hut was still filled with red light. So I looked out the window, and the whole valley, the ordinations take place in this mountain valley. The whole valley, the whole sky was filled with this red light. It was really a special, magical moment for me. And it could just be coincidence. You could say it's coincidence for me. It felt very special, very magical that there was this kind of amazing red sunset in the sky. So another orderman that was with me turned to me and said, Amitabha, that's a good sign, Amitabha. He didn't know what the kind of question process had been answering, but that felt like that was... yeah, that was the right Buddha for me. So people who know me would probably know me as a feeling type, a kind of emotion type, a heart type. It's not how I knew myself when I came to the Buddhist Centre. I didn't really experience a lot of emotion. I was quite blocked. Emotions weren't flowing that freely, but friends would probably see me as an emotion type, a feeling type. I came to the Buddhist Centre hating conflict. I don't like conflict, so just want to, I'd much more prioritise keeping peace over getting truth, really. It didn't matter whether it's truth or not, I just wanted to keep the peace. And an addictive personality, you're going to, very sweet tooth, you might say. But then there is a, strength that can come with that personality type, which is, to see the potential in people, to see the best in people and want to draw that out. So I feel really lucky, really blessed that my role now as Mitra Convener involves that, just trying to help people to grow, to see the best in people, help people, encouraging them to grow. So you get enlightened. Vidanya said last week, you get enlightened through your strengths. So what would that look like for me? What are for other people on this path, this gateway to enlightenment? What would that look like to be enlightened through the path of the heart, through emotion, through heart? And can practicing metta, can practicing loving kindness be a path to enlightenment? Is that just kind of wishful thinking, or kind of didn't the Buddha, the historical Buddha, teach that you just focus on your own mental states and you try and see through your own ego and break your own mental fetters? Why isn't this focus on love? Is this a degeneration of Buddhism? Is this a kind of, can this be a path? Well, the answer is yes, it is a path, and it was a path taught by the historical Buddha. It's maybe perhaps not given the emphasis it warrants, but there's a really beautiful and important sutta, which is discourse from the Buddha, historical Buddha, called the Karaniya Metta Sutta. And it's a teaching by the Buddha on loving kindness, how to practice loving kindness. It's a teaching from the historical Buddha about the path of the heart, the path of loving kindness, and how that leads all the way to enlightenment, all the way to wisdom, to enlightenment. And it's a very beautiful sutta, very beautiful read, and we're going to hear it read shortly by Vidanya. And it gets read out at Mitra ceremony, so you might associate it as well with your own Mitra ceremony if you become a Mitra. You can also hear it chanted if you go to India. Indian Buddhists will chant it, a very beautiful chant of the Karaniya Metta Sutta. So the sutra evokes enlightenment in terms of the heart. What would that be like to have that heart of Amitabha, which loves without limits, just radiates love out without any limits? What would that feel like? What would that look like? And the sutta also describes a path. It actually tells you how you can do it. How can you cultivate that heart? How can you transform and transmute craving into this loving kindness? So it's a really important sutta for me. So I shall ask Vidanya to read out the Karaniya Metta Sutta.
The Karaniya Metta Sutta. If you know what is truly good for you and want to reach a state of perfect peace, then this is how you need to live. Start by becoming a capable person who is honest and straightforward, gently spoken, flexible, and not conceited. Then become contented and happy with few worries and a simple life. Keep your sense experience calm and controlled. Have respect for others. Avoid greed and craving. Don't be influenced by the ways of the world. And don't do anything unworthy that wiser people would criticize. Then you should meditate like this, thinking, may all beings be happy and secure. May all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. May all living things be well, the weak and the strong, the small and the large, those near and those far away, those you can see and those you cannot, whether living now or yet to be born, may all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. May no one deceive or look down on another. May no one be angry with another. May no one react to another. May no one want another to suffer. Just as a mother cherishes her child, her only child, develop an unlimited heart of friendliness for all things. Develop an unlimited heart of friendliness for the whole universe, sending love and goodwill in all directions, above, below, and all around. Beyond all narrowness, beyond all rivalry, beyond all hatred. Whether you are at home or traveling, whether you are standing, sitting, or in bed, in all your hours rest in this state of mind, which is like living in heaven right here and now. In this way, you will leave all wrong views far behind. You will experience the spiritual insight that is beyond words and concepts, and going completely beyond craving, you will be liberated from the wheel of samsara forever.
Thank you, Vidanya. So a very beautiful teaching from the Buddha about the path of friendliness, a path of loving kindness, of love without limits, and how that can be a gateway right the way through to enlightenment. That also is what that particular arrangement translation of the sutta has been, it was done by Vidanya, so thank you for that particularly beautiful arrangement of the sutta. So what I'm going to do for the rest of the talk is just look at this text in relation to Amitabha. What is this path? What is this teaching on metta telling us about the path of loving kindness? How can that be a path to awakening, a path to wisdom? So the Buddha starts off with quite an attractive statement. He says, if you want to know what is truly good for you and you want to reach a state of perfect peace, then this is how you need to live. So it's quite, it sounds quite attractive. If you're a greed type like I am, that's quite attractive to start off with. If you want to know what's really good for you and want to reach a state of perfect peace, great, what is it? How? What can I do? What do I eat? What do I, what can I buy? So it sounds like it's like the advert for the best product in the universe. Actually, well, it is the best product in the universe. If the advertising people made an advert for it, you wouldn't believe it. People wouldn't believe it was true. But this is what is truly good for you and what will lead to a state of perfect peace. So it sounds attractive. This is what's truly good for you. But it's not just about knowing what's good for you. It's about how you live. The Buddha then challenges us, well, this is how you need to live. It's not just enough to know what's good for you. You need to live in a particular way. You need to live by it if you want to reach perfect peace. So how do we need to live? What is it we need to do? How do we need to live to reach this state of perfect peace? It might be surprising to some of you what the Buddha says next. He says, to start by becoming a capable person. It's quite an odd thing to say, isn't it, perhaps? Start by becoming a capable person. So the Buddha assumes, probably rightly for myself, maybe for others, that we don't start off as a capable person. There's quite a bit of work we need to do before we can really actually start a spiritual life proper. There may be stuff from our life we need to sort out. There might be stuff from our past baggage we've got. There might be psychological stuff we need to sort out. In a sense, we need to start off by becoming a capable person. Sangha actually does use a phrase elsewhere, to become a happy, healthy human being. That's a start, in a way, is to become a happy, healthy human being. I mean, that's been great to achieve. That most people in life want to achieve that. That's the start, in a way, for Buddhism. Become a capable person, a happy, healthy person. That's the start. We need to get some just basic... We may not have some of the basic human qualities we need, actually, just to be a capable person. It reminds me of a friend of mine who, really, really bright young man, who lives at a retreat centre. And when he arrived at the retreat centre, really wanting to practice the Buddhist path, realised, well, he didn't know how to work, he didn't know how to have a job, so he needed a training in just how to have a job, how to have responsibility, how to work. Anyway, he needed to become a capable person, those are basic qualities we need to start with. So maybe for some of us, there might be psychological work to sort out. We talk about integration at the start of the path. and positive emotion, becoming a happy, healthy person. Someone who can take care of yourself and then also other people, by implication, you can take care of other people. If you can't take care of yourself, how can you expect to take care of other people? So you need to start by becoming capable, learning how to look after yourself and looking after other people. So it's, yeah, maybe a surprising place that the Buddha starts. Start by becoming a capable person who is honest and straightforward, gently spoken, flexible, and not conceited. So yeah, what becomes apparent, the Buddha is talking about how to practice metta, but he doesn't start with metta. He doesn't start with the Amitabha and metta. He starts off with ethics, becoming an honest person, a straightforward, upright, ethical person, speaking gently, being flexible, not being humble, not being conceited. So the whole structure of the sutra, you might not be able to see this, but there's a famous rendering of the Buddhist path. Sometimes we talk about the Eightfold Path, you might have heard about on the intermediate course. Well, on the intro course, we use a structure of the Threefold Path, which is also very famous. In the Buddha's final year, apparently, he went around just really exhorting people to practice the Threefold Path of ethics, meditation, and wisdom. And there's a sense in which they are sequential and linear. You can't just go to wisdom. A lot of us might want to just start reading lots of wisdom books and practicing lots of wisdom meditations, but actually they are sequential. You can't just go straight to wisdom and become a wise person. You can't just go straight to meditation and become a really loving person. You have to start off with your ethical habits. You know, that's a starting point. That's where you have to start off. So there's a state that's kind of sequential. They are linear. But as you explore them, you also see they're not completely linear, because they all influence each other. There's a sense in which, you know, you start off by trying to become more generous, more kind. You act in a more kind way, a more generous way. But then your state of mind becomes more expansive. You become a more generous, loving personality. And so your meditation, you know, becomes transformed, and you see more clearly. So ethics can lead to wisdom. It can lead to, you know, if you act ethically, you can see the world more wisely. We'll look at that later. And there's a sense in which in meditation you are working ethically. We're working karmically to change ethical habits of our mind. In meditation we are working on ethics some of the time. Some of the time we're working on wisdom in meditation as well. So meditation kind of straddles ethics and meditation. The three are interlinked, they're interconnected, as everything is. But there's a sequential path. You can't just go straight to wisdom. You can't just even go straight to radiating loving kindness for all beings. You have to start with who you are. You have to start with where you're at. And so for all of us, really, that means ethics is the most important thing. And it's saying, you know, people said, I remember my most influential meditation teacher is a guy called Satyaraja who lives at Padmaloka. And his advice is, if you want your meditation to go deeper, keep an ethical diary. Often people talk about keeping a meditation diary. He says, well, keep an ethical diary. Focus on your ethics and your state of minds, and your meditation practice will go deeper. So we need to take ethics really seriously, really importantly. And so the Buddha says, yeah, become a capable person who is honest and straightforward, gently spoken, flexible, and not conceited. Yeah, so if we want to change our responses and have responses of metta, of loving kindness, then we need to act in kind ways, we need to act in unselfish ways, in generous ways, and that will erode the craving, that will start to transmute the poison of craving that Amitabha transmutes into the wisdom of Amitabha. So we can choose to strengthen particular volitions or weaken volitions, you know, through the law of karma, by what we choose to put our action behind, what we choose to act on or not act on. So we begin with ethics, and the whole first chunk of this sutta is all about how to practice ethics, but in particular how to practice ethics in a way that undermines and transforms craving, because that is the particular poison that this path is associated with. So then the Buddha says, then become contented and happy. Again, it doesn't sound like a basic practice. Become contented and happy with few worries and a simple life. So the Buddha's talking about contentment and a simple life, which is all about the third precept, the third ethical precept, which is the positive counterpart to the poison of craving. It's stillness, simplicity, and contentment. So, yeah, stillness. Why? You know, why stillness? Why is stillness important? Well, the figure of Amitabha is, as I said before, is a very still figure, seated still, calm, relaxed. He's not kind of full of this kind of inner tension, which, for me, cravings are often associated with the kind of tension that I feel like I need to get rid of somehow, and the cravings are a way of getting rid of that tension. Amitabha is completely relaxed, completely at ease, just completely still. So for most of us, we need to cultivate stillness. You know, our part of craving can come from anxiety, it can come from restlessness. You know, that we just lead such busy lives. And we need to cultivate stillness. We need to cultivate times, moments in our days, in our lives, where we're just still, we're not busy, we're not rushing. And then, you know, the voice of Amitabha, the wiser part of ourselves, we're more likely to hear that when our mind is still, our body is still. So not easy, but we need to cultivate stillness in our life. Just moments when we're not busy, we're not doing anything, we're just still. Simplicity is the second part of this precept. So craving leads to complexity. And I've heard another friend of mine, Padmavadri, says, well, you know, modern life is so complicated for so many people, their lives are so complicated. It's difficult to practice Buddhism because our lives are so complicated. There's so much going on in our lives. Complexity in our lives can lead to just a lack of fulfillment. We can find ourselves I find myself doing so many different things. I can't do any of them well. I can't kind of fully attend to any one of the things. I'm doing so many things that my life is too complex. So, yeah, the Buddha is exhorting us to live more simply, to live a simple life with few worries. So that's, in its highest ideal, seen in the renunciate life of the monk or the nun, who just, as the Buddha was said to just have no possessions, a robe and a bowl, which might seem very challenging to us. But there's a scale of how many possessions do we need? How complicated does our life really need to be? How simple could we make our life? What would that lead to? What states of mind would it lead to if we really simplified our life? I'm moving house in a few days. Very complicated thing to do. A lot of complexity. It's also been an opportunity just to really sort through all my possessions and think, do I really need all those boxes? Actually, because I'm a craving type, yeah, I do. That's my response. I do need all those boxes of books and other possessions. But there's been a real opportunity to think, and do I need all that stuff, just to sort through and just to see how much stuff you accumulate in your life. We've been living in this house for 10 years and I've got cupboards full of stuff that I've never looked at, never used. Just all these possessions that we accumulate. So we end up owning so much stuff for such a complicated life that if we had fewer possessions, we'd have fewer worries. If we had a simpler life, we'd have fewer worries. So it's challenging, and particularly in our society where there's so much pressure in the opposite way, but that's the challenge, to lead a simple life. And I've heard it said that Indian order members sometimes come to stay in the West and are just shocked by the way Western order members live, the amount of stuff we have, the amount of possessions, the size of houses that we have. They're kind of shocked by the lack of simplicity in our lives. And I've got another anecdote from my ordination course, living in the mountains for 4 months, as Tansel and Dave will be doing soon. They're going to go away for 4 months and be ordained. It was the simplest I've ever lived for 16 weeks, just living with hardly any possessions, hardly any complexity. My whole life, every day, was just about the Dharma, about the three jewels, about meditation, about study. It was the happiest I've ever been, actually. It's the most contented I've ever been, and happiest I've ever been. So the real clue, really, to how to cultivate contentment and how to cultivate happiness, actually, is through a simple life with a simple routine that you can follow. So it's a challenge, but Buddhism is a challenge. It's a challenge to rise to. How simple could we live? And then the precept and the Buddha also talk about contentment, developing contentment. And I once asked Padmavajra, because I'm not, this isn't my strength, contentment. I'm a greed type, a craving type. So how do I cultivate contentment? And he thought about it and said, well, just reflect on what you've already got in your life that you're content with. And that answer kind of pointed to me towards different mentalities we could have. We can have a mentality which we can call a poverty mentality, where we focus on our lack. We just have a real sense of our lack, what we lack, the things we don't have. And that leads to craving. The fruit of that, you know, the result of that is we want to fill that lack. We want more things. We want to try and fill that lack. But we can also have a state of mind which is focused on what we do have, appreciating what we have. So we can then, that leads to a sense of abundance, a sense of richness. And we might not actually have that many possessions, but we feel really rich. We have an inner richness, an inner abundance. So it points as well towards this wisdom of Amitabha, the kind of contentment is associated with a sense of inner abundance, inner richness, not a kind of what's very commonly, we can commonly experience a sense of lack, a kind of poverty mentality. So the Buddha says, you know, we need to work on craving. The Buddha says, well, we need to become contented and happy with few worries and a simple life. And the Buddha says to avoid greed and craving. So the whole emphasis on this first ethical part is how to work with greed, how to work with craving. So, yeah, avoid greed and craving. Well, again, how do we do this? How do we avoid greed and craving? And the Buddha goes on to say, keep your sense experience calm and controlled. Keep your sense experience calm and controlled. Which again is a challenge within our modern life. We have so much sense experience. Many people constantly glued to their mobile phones, to kind of social media, to TV, to advertising, newspaper, radio. There's so many things coming at us, sense experiences coming at us, which our sense experience often isn't controlled, it isn't calm, it's uncontrolled. We're not in control of it, just stuff coming at us all the time. So, yeah, again, it's a challenge to keep your sense experience calm, to keep your sense experience controlled. That will lead to contentment, it will lead to happiness, to peace. And the time I experience this most, again, is on retreat. So if I'm on retreat, if you're going on retreat, it's really important just to leave behind gadgets, leave behind phones, turn them off, leave behind technology, leave behind, basically leave all of that behind, because it's an opportunity just to be away from sense experience and just experience what the fruits of that can be like, experience the states of peace that can come about from calming down your sense experience. So yeah, it's an opportunity just to leave behind your phone, your gadgets, technology, and experience, yeah, contentment. And to begin with, for me, there's a kind of panic. Where's my phone? What was my phone? And kind of waiting for the buzz in my pocket of a message or an email. But you know, that kind of goes after a day or so, and then it's just relaxation, just kind of relief, letting go. Don't have to worry about the world and my phone and the internet and football and all the rest of it, and just let go of it all and relax, actually. And then starts states of peace and contentment can really start to open up. And how often I come out of a meditation and straight away go to my phone and look and see if any messages have come or any emails. It's just a really ingrained habit, which is very difficult in our society to avoid. So Buddha didn't have all of those things, but he still really exhorted people to keep your sense experience calm and controlled. And then the Buddha talks about a different type of craving, a particular type of craving. He says, have respect for other people. Don't be influenced by the ways of the world. Don't do anything unworthy that wiser people would criticize. Don't do anything unworthy that wiser people would criticize. So there's a particular type of craving which we can have, is a craving for approval, a craving for praise, and we want to avoid blame. We want to have status. We want people to like us. We want to be approved of. So we can crave that, and we can end up doing things which might be unethical because we want to be approved of. You know, that can be our driver. And we can also end up, I ended up just sometimes just feeling guilty, not having done anything, like, because maybe someone had disapproved of me, but I hadn't done anything wrong. And it's really confusing to think, well, how do I get my own sense of esteem, my own sense of value and worth, if it's always dependent on what other people think about me? That's out of my control. I can't control what others think about me. So where do you get your sense of value from? Well, the answer, again, is ethics for me. The answer is the five precepts. If you commit to and start living by the five precepts, that gives you a reference point to say, well, have I done anything to feel guilty about or ashamed about? Or can I just feel pleased with myself? Can I feel good about myself? Have I acted ethically? And then whose opinion do I care about? Whose judgment is important to me? Is it my school friends who will take the mickey out of me for being a Buddhist? Or is it the kind of wiser people I know who have become you know, become really compassionate and kind, and you know, whose opinion actually is more important to me, whose approval is more important. So there's two ethical terms associated with this. The first one was a term called kri, H-R-I-H, kri. And this is our own internal sense of discomfort or unease we can feel when we know we've done something unethical. It's almost like we kind of blush on the inside and the outside. There's a sense of kind of shame or kind of discomfort, or you know, I don't feel comfortable with what I've done there. It's a kind of very positive ethical state, actually. It's uncomfortable, but very positive. It's like your ethical antennae has become sharper, more accurate. And so, you know, this is very strongly associated with Amitabha, syllable kri. And again, this colour of red, of blushing, you know, we have a sense of shame, blushing on the inside when we know we've done something we shouldn't have done. So there's, you know, we can become our own judge of whether we, you know, whether we're worthy or not, you know, based on our own action. And then there's a second term, apatrapia, which I won't spell out, it's written up there. Apatrapia is the sense of shame or discomfort we can feel when we think of what our friends who we really respect, those wiser than us, might think about what we've just done or what we might be about to do. So sometimes it can be really helpful preventative measure, because you think, oh, I better not do that. What would my friends think? Or I've got a confession practice with my friend. I'm going to have to tell them about this if I do this. That can be a really helpful deterrent as well. If you practice confession with a group of close friends, like in a chapter or Mitra group or GFR group, then this form of apatrapia can be a preventative measure. You can think, oh, I don't want to be unskillful because I don't want to have to tell them about it, basically. So you know, that sense of just seeing yourself through the eyes of your friends and then feeling the discomfort about what they might think, or letting them down, that could be very, again, very positive, a very positive ethical sense. So the Buddha says, don't do anything unworthy that wiser people would criticise. Okay, so there's a big chunk about ethics. The whole first section of the sutta is about ethics. But then the Buddha says, he gets to the kind of the crux, the kind of the juice of the sutta, the path of the heart. Then you should meditate like this, thinking, may all beings be happy and secure. May all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. May all living things be well. The weak and the strong, the small and the large, those near and those far away, those you can see and those you can't, whether living now or yet to be born, may all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. Very, very beautiful sentiment, beautiful volition, intention, desire, aspiration. May all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. And this is the practice of the Metta-bhavana. This is what we're trying to do. This is what we're trying to reach, trying to cultivate in the Metta-bhavana practice. That wish, that aspiration, that desire, may all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. The Metta-bhavana is a crucial practice, and cultivating love and compassion is perhaps now more than ever really needed in our world, for people to respond with compassion, to respond with love. It's what the world needs, and it's what we need as well. So the Buddha says you should meditate like this. You should do the Metta-bhavana. Do it every day. Do it twice a day. Do it three times a day. Meditate like this. May all living beings be happy. May all living beings be well. And the Buddha describes how to go about the practice in a particular way. It's similar to how we do the practice now, how we teach it, you know, 2,500 years later. You know, slightly different, but it's very similar. So the Buddha describes categories of people, different categories of people. And that the idea is you're trying to cultivate love, you know, metta to all these different people. So the weak and the strong, the small and the large. So often craving is all about our likes and our dislikes. We're happy to feel kind towards people we like, but you know, not the people we dislike, not the people that wind us up. But this is about all people, all categories of people, whether they're healthy or ill, whether they're weak or strong, small or large. So it might be whether they're Liverpool fans or even Man United fans, all categories of people, we need to respond with metta, with loving kindness towards them. So yeah, it's going against our likes, our dislikes, but everybody, all people. So we, you know, we use slightly different categories, but it's a similar principle. There's these different categories of relationships we have with people, and we're looking for the same response of loving kindness, of metta, wanting them all to be happy like we want to be happy. And the Buddha uses a geographical method as well, like we do in the fifth stage. We often teach a geographical method. The Buddha says those near us and those far away. So those in the room with us now, those people in Sheffield, those people are far away. Everybody wants to be happy. So meditate like this. May all beings be happy in their heart of hearts. And again, why doesn't the Buddha just go straight to this? Why doesn't the Buddha say, well, go straight to the practice of Metta-bhavana? Well, of course we do. We teach people on week two the Metta-bhavana. We teach people straight away. We practice it straight away. But without ethics, without that earlier stage of the path, it's not going to go very deep. You know, we need to be really working on our habits and the practice will get momentum, it'll get deeper. If all the time off the cushion we're working on loving kindness, cultivating loving kindness in the bus queue, in the supermarket queue at work, all the time, but may these people be well, may these people be happy, it becomes a kind of constant practice. So if we're practicing these ethical, we're acting kindly, then our meditation is going to go deeper. So the Buddha doesn't go straight to metta, he starts off with ethics first. But this is the meat, this is the kind of crux of it. Maybe meat isn't the right Buddhist context. This is the heart of the practice. This is the juice of the practice, the meditation, the metta-bhava meditation. And then the Buddha goes further. He says, well, may no one deceive or look down on another. May no one be angry with another. May no one react to another. May no one want another to suffer. It's not just you wanting metta for other people. It's you wanting other people to experience metta for other people. You wanted all beings to experience that loving kindness, that heart of metta. You know, may other people not want each other to be happy. But may all that just enmity and hatred in the world, all that anger, all that deception, all those reactions, may no one react in that way. May everybody experience this loving kindness. So it's an aspiration, it's a wish. So when we're reciting those phrases in the Metta-bhavana to ourselves, may you progress, may they progress. This is the type of progression we're talking about. It's for them to become more metta for themselves, to experience those states of mind that you want to experience. You want the same thing for them. May they experience peace of mind. May they not want other people to be angry. May they experience metta and love. I think that's my favourite part of the whole sutta. I don't know why, it's just that image of no one. It's like it's just everyone in all the world's problems have been solved by metta. No one wanting another person to be unhappy or suffer. No one deceiving anybody else. May no one look down on anybody else. No one be angry with anybody else. It's just it just paints a real beautiful, well, you could say a pure land. Amitabha is associated with a pure land, which I've not got time to go into tonight, but you could say, well, that's the description of a pure land, a Buddha field. And then there's this next section. Just as a mother cherishes her child, her only child, develop an unlimited heart of friendliness for all beings. So this is very potent, particularly for myself. I've become a parent in the last few years. And, you know, I've learned about this phrase long before. I've been practicing metta long before I became a parent. But it became a benchmark to be able to say, okay, well, I know what that feels like. I know how much I love my son, my children, now my daughter. So what would that be like to feel that for strangers or to feel that for enemies? What would it be like to feel that love for all beings? What is the love of a parent like? We may have experienced the love of our own parents, or we may have see other friends who are parents. And what is that love of a parent like, the love of a mother or a father? It's a cherishing. It's a cherishing love. A love that really cherishes the other person. Really, they're really, really important. So imagine if all beings, you cherished all beings as much as your only child. It's a love that nurtures, that wants to nurture, it wants to develop, wants the child to grow, wants the child to be healthy, to be happy, to grow. It's a love that rejoices in the success of the child. It's a nurturing love. A protecting love. So imagine how strong that would be to feel that for all beings, even your enemies, even strangers. I mean, yeah, so it's a benchmark, but it's not, I mean, it's important to draw a distinction. Parental love isn't necessarily the same as metta, because it can be very, very exclusive. It's very, very exclusive, directed to one person at the expense of other people. So, for example, if another child upsets my child, I don't feel metta, I feel real rage, real indignation. I can feel myself boiling with rage, even if it's my niece over Christmas upsetting my child. How dare you upset my child? There's a real indignation. So a parent's love is very protective, and you know it sees other beings as a threat, you know, to its own child. So metta isn't like that. Metta is non-exclusive. Metta is without limits for all beings, but it's as powerful as that. So the Buddha says, develop an unlimited heart of friendliness for the whole universe, sending love and goodwill in all directions. Above, below, and all around. Beyond all narrowness, beyond all rivalry, beyond all hatred. So for me, this is, it evokes the image of the Buddha Amitabha, just seated, meditating, radiating love in all directions for the whole universe, sending love and goodwill in all directions, without limits, beyond all narrowness, beyond all hatred, beyond all rivalry. So yeah, the Buddha is the Buddha of infinite light. So again, there's this association with just light shining everywhere, this kind of warm red light shining on all beings in all directions. It's love without limits. Whether you're at home or travelling, whether you're standing or sitting or in bed, in all your hours rest in this state of mind, which is like living in heaven right here and now. So hopefully this will already be familiar with the idea that metta is one of the Brahma Viharas, that metta is like living in heaven right here and now. The Buddha taught that heaven isn't a place that you go to when you die if you've been good. Heaven is a state of mind you can experience right here and right now if you cultivate a state of metta, a heart of metta. It would be like living in heaven right here and now. So yeah, our experience of the outer world is filtered through our state of mind. We actually live, we dwell in our state of mind, so whatever state of mind we dwell in, that's the world we experience. That influences how we experience the world. So we inhabit our state of mind, we dwell in our state of mind. So if we dwell in a state of metta, that's like dwelling in heaven, right here and now. So you get a sense of how the path of metta can lead to that state of peace, which the Buddha tempted us with at the start. It's like living in heaven, right here and now. Yeah, and again, you can see why ethics comes first, because if we act with loving kindness, we develop acts of loving kindness, our mind becomes more expansive, more open, as a result, our heart becomes more open as a result of acting ethically, acting with deeds of loving kindness. And then we begin to see and experience the world as more interconnected. We start to experience ourselves as being less separate, less isolated from other people, more connected to other people. So we begin to see more and more wisely this wisdom of interconnectedness. So through acting with metta, cultivating a heart of metta, we begin to see through the wisdom of interconnectedness, the wisdom of metta. So you can see how wisdom is metta is a path to wisdom. So rather than focusing on ourself and trying to almost undo our ego, we can almost tie ourselves in knots, Sangha Lakshita says, if we try and focus on the self, which we then learn doesn't exist in the way we think it does, it becomes a bit confusing. We can tie ourselves in knots. He says it's much healthier, much more wholesome, much makes more sense for us to just focus on others. If we want to kind of work on this separation between self and others and our own selfishness, actually focus on other people, bend the straw the other way, start to focus on other people. And that can lead to wisdom. It can lead to that kind of barrier between self and other becoming dissolved, and us starting to experience ourselves and see the world as being less separate from us feeling more connected, more a part of what's around us, less separated from us. So developing, acting from metta, developing metta leads to a state of wisdom. So you can dissolve that barrier of self and other through the practice of compassion, through the practice of love. And then we've got, it can just erode this wrong view that happiness comes from focusing on ourself, that happiness comes from looking after number one. So we cultivate a loving state of mind, we cultivate loving actions, we erode craving, we cultivate contentment. And then, we cultivate a heart of compassion, of love, and we dwell in that state. And then we see the world as interconnected. So the Buddha ends by saying, in this way, you will leave all wrong views far behind. You will experience the spiritual insight that is beyond words and concepts. And going completely beyond craving, you will be liberated from the wheel of samsara forever. Yes, hopefully this is just, this sutta has illustrated how if you erode craving, you really weaken craving through the practice of ethics. If you really practice the metta bhavana meditation, really cultivate that heart of metta, heart of loving kindness, it can be a path to being liberated from samsara, it can be a path to wisdom. And you can end up cultivating this wisdom of Amitabha that sees the positive qualities in people and really, really loves them. It's a wisdom that just cherishes people like they're your child, even enemies, even strangers. You can see what's positive and really love other people for it. And that is a wisdom, that is a path to enlightenment in itself, a gateway to enlightenment. So I've spoken for too long, so I shall end there. And hopefully you've got a flavour of the path of the heart, the path of Amitabha.